So in the last lecture, we have mentioned that in any analog circuit, we can also use the current mirror as an active load. More specifically, we have used this current mirror circuit as a load in a differential pair amplifier. In fact, in unit 3, we have seen that we can design the differential amplifier using different types of loads. For example, we have initially started with a simple resistive kind of load like RD, which was connected between the power supply line VDD to the drain of each of the individual transistors. And then that particular resistance can also be realized by virtue of diode connected load or a current source load. Now, since the operation of a current mirror circuit is to copy the current, so instead of using it like a passive device, we can always use it like an active device. What is the meaning of active load? So as you understand, whenever we talk about current source as a biasing element, so then the amount of current that is flowing through the combination is remaining constant. It is basically copying a current. So we have some reference current source, I reference, and the current source or this current mirror circuit tries to get a copy of that. But whenever we have used the current mirror as an active load in the last lecture, we have seen that the current that is passing through the current mirror circuit is also varying with respect to the time, because we have applied some time varying signal at the two gates of the differential pair amplifier. Now, last day we have made some qualitative discussion regarding the gain of a differential pair amplifier with a single ended output node. That means the differential pair amplifier that we're talking about is not fully differential, in the sense that the input is differential, but we are taking the output from single terminal, unlike the traditional full differential pair, in which case you have the outputs from each of the two drain terminals, and we are taking the difference of the output. Now today, I'll be discussing about the corresponding mathematical derivation of the gain for a single-ended differential pair amplifier with active load. Now to start with, let me once again draw the circuit diagram, which we have discussed last time. So let me start with from this point. So we have on the top, you have this drain supply, that is VDD, and then you have the current mirror, which is acting as a load over here. So we have a situation like this. PMOS device, a diode connected one. So I think it will be better if I just rotate the device. In this way. So this is a PMOS device we are talking about, for which the gate and the drain terminal are shorted. And apart from that, you have another PMOS device. And these two together provide you the corresponding current mirror circuit. And then we have the input devices, input MOS devices, which are basically the NMOS devices. Now they are connected in differential mode. Their sources are tied together, and then you have the tail current source. yes. So these are the two MOS devices, two NMOS devices. So we may call like M1 and M2. So these are the input devices, and they are responsible for magnification, for amplification. And if I call these two devices like M3 and M4, so they are acting as load. And remember that this time we have used some current mirror type of load. And the output is obtained from this terminal. So it's a single-ended output. And last time, while making the qualitative analysis or qualitative discussion, I have mentioned that whenever the input is provided like this, a differential input, suppose from the common mode level, if some positive delta V is applied at the gate of M1 and negative delta V applied at the gate of M2, then accordingly, last time we have proved that qualitatively, the V out will be enhanced because of the application of this type of differential input. Now, I can always call these two inputs like VIN1 and VIN2. And whenever we are talking about the differential per amplifier with the active load, so in that case, the gain, the voltage gain, is basically defined in terms of the output voltage, which is single-ended one, because we are just measuring this output with respect to ground potential upon the differential input. So there is a certain difference with respect to the traditional differential per amplifier with which we are familiar. In case of traditional differential per amplifier, we have seen that these two MOS devices, they are used for amplification. And apart from that, we have two loads, and the outputs are taken as the difference between the corresponding two output. Like if I call this terminal as X and this terminal as Y, then the output voltage is given by Vx minus Vy. And then the gain expression is nothing but Vx minus Vy upon VIN1 minus VIN2. Or I can also say Vout1 minus Vout2 upon VIN1 minus VIN2. So that was the expression for a fully differential pair amplifier. Now here, last day I have mentioned that suppose this is a differential pair amplifier, and the next stage which follows this one is a single-ended amplifier. So that particular stage only accepts some single-ended input. So obviously, this differential pair must be providing some single-ended output. Now we have to ensure that the output value for a particular value of VIN1 and VIN2, the gain that we are getting over here, this AV, is not sacrificed. So that we have to prove today, that whatever the gain over here, so that gain is comparable with what we have got in case of fully differential pair amplifier with current source load or diode connected load. But remember, this circuit that we're talking about, this circuit is not at all symmetric. So if the circuit is symmetric, then we can go for the half circuit concept, and accordingly we can find out the expression for each of the circuit, each of the half. And we have seen that this expression, I mean, if I call this resistance like RD, we have a drain resistance like RD, then already we have proved in unit number 3 that each of these stage, half left-hand side and the right-hand side, they are having a gain equal to minus Gm times RD. And accordingly, the overall gain of the differential pair was given by minus Gm times RD. But this time we cannot apply this half-circuit concept because the circuit is not at all symmetric. Because last time we have seen that if we have a diode connected load, so both of them are diode connected, or we can also have a current source load. But this time we have some asymmetric nature. We have some current mirror used as an active load over here. So we cannot go by the corresponding half circuit concept. So what is the option available to us to calculate the gain for this circuit? In fact, we are interested in calculating this one, Vout upon V0 minus V2. Now to calculate this one, obviously we have to go by the corresponding small signal model, and accordingly we can solve this expression, this V out upon VIN1 minus VIN2. So let me start with the corresponding small signal model. So in fact, you have four devices, four MOS devices, M1, M2, M3, and M4. And remember that out of these four devices, this M3 is used as a diode connected mode. That means this gate and drain, it is shorted, and the source is connected to VDD. So therefore, whenever you observe the implication of M3 in a small signal equivalent circuit, so this is nothing but 1 upon Gm parallel combination with R naught. R naught is nothing but the output impedance of that particular device. So we have already analyzed this direct connected load in perhaps in unit 2 while discussing the common source amplifier. So there you have seen that the corresponding impedance, the impedance from this point to this point. So this point, this is the drain terminal of MOS 3, and this is the source terminal of MOS 3. So between these two terminals, the impedance was given by 1 upon GM in parallel with R naught. R naught is the output impedance of this MOS, which is nothing but the variation of ID with respect to the corresponding variation of VDS. Now, so that particular thing, if I write it down over here, so for a direct connected load, we know that this R out, so this is nothing but this 1 upon GM, and it is in shunt with this RO. So that is equal to 1 upon GM multiplied with RO divided by 1 upon GM plus RO. So if I just multiply both numerator and denominator with GM, then we find that it is given by R naught by 1 plus GM times R naught. Now, this GM R naught, this product is much, much larger as compared to 1. So that can be approximated to R naught upon GM times R naught, and which is equal to 1 upon GM. So this for a direct connected load, this output impedance can be simply represented by 1 upon GM. In fact, so whenever we have this device M3 connected between these two terminals, so its appearance in the small signal equivalent circuit is nothing but a simple resistance, a resistive element whose value is equal to 1 upon GM. Now, with this basic understanding, let us now try to draw the small signal diagram, small signal equivalent circuit for this particular differential pair amplifier. So I think, let me just complete in this particular slide only. Otherwise, we have to once again draw this diagram. So it will help you because it has been shown side by side. So I think I can go with a different color. So first, let us take a look at this MOS, that is M1. Now it is simple common source stage. So input is applied at the gate. So we can think that we have some external input, that is VIN1. So that was connected between the gate and the ground. That is VIN1. So this terminal is connected to the ground, the gate terminal. And between gate to source, suppose the voltage difference is V1. If I call this voltage difference is V1. And then you have this voltage dependent current source. So I'm not just writing down over here because it will create, or it will take much space. I'll show outside. So as you understand, this is nothing but GM1 times V1, this current source, and we have RO1. Then once again, we have to consider this one. I think I can just show it over here. So this is nothing but GM1 times V1, and this one is nothing but RO1. Now, what about the second, this MOS M2? For M2 also, we have seen that the input is applied at the gate and their sources are tied together. So this is the source terminal, source end. The sources are tied together. So what I can do is I can just flip the small signal equivalent circuit horizontally, and we can draw the circuit. So if I just flip it horizontally, then it will be something like that. So this is the drain terminal. This is the source terminal. Between drain to source, you have the output resistance, that is RO2. And these two source terminals are connected together. What else? We have VIN2 applied externally between the ground terminal and the gate. So this is Vin2, and between the gate and source, this voltage is V2, for example. So once again, we can mark these two elements. So this is nothing but RO2. So initially, let us start with RO1 and RO2, and finally, we can think that if I consider these two MOS are identical in nature, then we can make RO1 equal to RO2 and GM1 equal to GM2. But in general, I have to write like GM2 times V2. So this is all about these two MOS devices, M1 and M2. But remember that this potential, I mean, if I call this terminal as point P, but this point P is not at AC ground because the circuit is not symmetric. Now, what about the other appearance, like for M3 and M4? Now, already I have told you that M3 is appeared as a resistance because it's a diode connected device. It will be appearing as a resistance whose value is equal to 1 upon GM. So now this is connected between the drain terminal of M1 and the ground, because VDD is nothing but AC ground. So this one is connected. So this is the drain terminal of MOS 1. So this is connected between the drain and the ground. This is AC ground, and this value is, let me write, this value is 1 upon GM3. 1 upon GM3, this resistance. And this is also the gate to source potential. So I think it will be better if I just first draw the equivalent circuit for M4. Now for M4, since it's a PMOS, so therefore the source is connected to VDD. So I can draw the same circuit by flipping it vertically. So now the source is upwards and the drain terminal is downwards. So we have this one. This is the source end. And this one is the drain end. And these two sources are connected together because their source is tied up to VDD, which is nothing but AC ground. So their sources are connected together. Now, for M3, the gate and drain is shorted because it's a diode connected device. So gate and drain is shorted. So this terminal, I can also think of that this is nothing but the gate terminal. Now, between gate to source, the corresponding potential, suppose this potential is equal to V3, gate to source, plus minus V3. And for M4 also, because their gates are tied up together, so for M4 also, this gate to source potential becoming V3. So ultimately, now we can mark the other elements. So this one is nothing but RO4, and this one is, I can write like GM4 times V3 only, because V3 and V4 being the same, because for M3 and M4, the gates are tied up together and their sources are connected together to VDD. So therefore, I can simply write GM4 times V3. But the circuit is not completed yet. We have this part is left. Now, as you understand, this drain of M4, it should be connected to the drain of M2. So we should have a connection, wire connection over here like this. And the output is obtained from this terminal with respect to ground. So this is the output terminal. So I can call this is V out with respect to the ground. So if I have a ground terminal over here, so V out is measured with respect to the ground terminal. So that is all about the small signal equivalent circuit. And from that, we need to find out the expression of AV. So AV is already defined like this, V out upon V in 1 minus V in 2. So already we have marked all the parameters like V in 1, V in 2, V out and all. I think I have marked all the internal components as well. And let me call, for example, let me call this point as point P. Let me call this point as point P, and let me call this point as point Q. And say the output terminal, say let this be represented by point O. So these are the three terminals, because I have to apply some KCL at these three nodes, so O, P and Q. So I have marked these three. Now one by one I have to apply the KCL, but before applying KCL, first of all let us try to understand what is the current that is flowing through this branch from this point to this point. What is the current, or what is the current that is flowing through this resistance 1 upon GM3? Now the current you can easily get just by observing the voltage drop and the resistance. What is the voltage drop? So voltage drop is V3, and what is the resistance? That is 1 upon GM3. So the current that is flowing through this resistance is nothing but V3 upon 1 upon GM3. So let me call this current as I3. Let me call this kind as I3, and the I3 is also flowing through this node, I mean through this path as well, because there is no provision for I3 to go over here, because as you understand, this is electrically isolated. So we have this current, so I can mark this I3 as V3 upon 1 upon GM3. That is equal to GM3 times V3. So gate and source for MOS M4, for M1, for M2, for all of them, gate and source, they are insulated. So obviously there is no provision for I3 to go over there. So this kind will flow through this path. So now first let us apply KCL, Kirchhoff's current law, over here at the output node, at node O. Now first let us apply KCL at output node, that is O. So if I apply KCL at output node, what I am getting? Now we have once again, you have to understand this particular topology. So this is the current that is flowing through M3, and since M3 and M4, they are the components of current mirror, so whatever the current that is flowing through M3, the same current will be flowing through M4. So if I3 is flowing through M3, so the same amount of current will also be copied over here. And let us assume that suppose this direction for the current is in this direction, I3. It will be same, because they are creating the current mirror, M3 and M4 together. So now if I apply KCL at this particular node, so now you find that from at this particular node, so there are three different currents which are leaving the node. One is this part, that is GM4 times V3. Second one is the I3, and the third one is this one, the current that is flowing through RO4. Now what is the current which is flowing through RO4? So what about this potential? The potential at this node, potential at this node is V out, and the potential at this node is zero. So what about the current that is flowing through RO4? Is nothing but V out upon RO4. So all of them are leaving the terminal O. So therefore, I can simply add them together and equate the result to zero. So I'm having GM4 V3 and I3 is GM3 V3 and V out upon RO4. Okay. So if I apply, we have GM3 times GM3 V3 plus GM4 V3 plus V out upon RO4, that is equal to zero. Now from that we can write like V3, GM3 plus GM4 is equal to minus Vout upon RO4. And if I assume that these two MOS devices, M3 and M4, they are identical in nature, having equal value of the transconductance, then I can simply write this as GMP, because this is coming from the PMOS. So with this, what I can write is V3 is equal to minus Vout upon, so we have 2 GMP RO4. Now this equation relates V3 with Vout. Then let us apply the Kirchhoff's current law KCL at this particular node. At this particular node, you have to identify the amount of current that is leaving. So one component is obviously I3. So as far as the notation is concerned, I3 is leaving the node Q, and the other component is obviously GM1 V1, and this component is the current that is flowing through RO1. So whatever the current which is flowing through RO1, that is potential at this point minus potential at this point divided by RO1. So I can write GM1. So now I can apply KCL at node Q. KCL at node Q. It says GM1 times V1 plus we have this I3 component, that is GM3 times V3, and plus the current which is flowing through this resistance, that is RO1. Now this current is nothing but VQ minus VP upon RO1. So in fact, as you understand, this potential at this point is also equal to V3. So instead of writing VQ, I can always write V3. Because the potential at point Q with respect to ground is V3. So therefore, it is equal to V3 minus VP upon RO1. So V3 minus VP upon RO1. So that is equal to 0, because all the current components are leaving the terminal. And then once again we have to apply the KCL at output node, but this time these currents will be considered. So now you see, out of 3 currents, 2 are leaving and 1 is just entering. So obviously we can simply find out the corresponding relation. So this one is obviously GM2 times V2, this current component, and this current is nothing but the potential drop Vout minus VP upon RO2. So that should be equal to I3. So now if I once again apply KCL at output node O, then we see KCL at node O will give me GM2 times V2 plus Vout minus VP by RO2 is equal to GM3 times V3, because 2 of them are leaving and 1 of them are just entering, so therefore it will be equal to that. So from that, what we can do is because ultimately we are interested in finding out the differential voltage gain. So if I call this as equation number 1 and this as equation number 2, if I call this as equation number 1 and this as equation number 2, then we can simply subtract equation 2 from equation 1. Then what we are getting is GM1. Once again, I can assume that GM1 and GM2, GM1 and GM2, so they refer to the transconductance of NMOS devices. So that can be written like GMN, suppose they are equal. And then accordingly, what we find is GMN V1 minus V2, V1 minus V2, and then we have once again, this RO1 and RO2 can also be considered to be same. That is the second assumption that we are making over here, that RO1 that is equal to RO2 that is equal to RON. That is the output resistance for NMOS device. So now if you just subtract this from this, then we have simply V3 minus Vout upon RON, because it's minus Vp by RON will get cancelled. So we have V3 minus Vout by RON. So this calculation is a little bit tedious, but ultimately we have to follow this one, V3 minus Vout upon RON. And then that was GM3 V3. So if I take GM3 V3 in one side, so minus GM3 V3, if you subtract, so then you find it is equal to twice GM3 V3. So plus twice GM3 V3 is equal to zero. Twice GM3 V3 is equal to zero. So instead of writing GM3, because already we have made this assumption that I think we have made it in the last, anyway, I can simply put, instead of writing GM3, I can simply write GMP, that is equal to zero. Hopefully in the last slide we have mentioned over here. So let me make a note that GM3 is equal to GM4 is equal to GMP, and RO4 is equal to, say, that is equal to ROP. So now with this understanding, let us now, we have to solve this one, this expression. But ultimately, we have to represent V out as a function of V in 1 and V in 2. But here, this expression is in terms of V on and V2. So then once again, we can find from this small signal model that V in 1 minus V1 is equal to V in 2 minus V2. V in 1 minus V1 is equal to V in 2 minus V2. That is equal to the potential at point P. So the condition is, already we have seen, V in 1 minus V1 is equal to V in 2 minus V2. So we suggest that V1 minus V2 is equal to V in 1 minus V in 2. So that we have observed from the small signal model. So then now we can, and another thing from the last slide, we can write down the expression for V3 in terms of V out. It was like V out upon twice GMP ROP. Twice GMP ROP. Now with this, let me just complete this part. So now we have GMN, and V1 minus V2 is nothing but V in 1 minus V in 2 plus, okay, so we have V3 by RON. So I can write like V3 is minus V out, so minus V out upon twice GMP ROP RON minus V out by RON, and then plus, no, this is also V3, so therefore we have to represent in terms of V out. So also minus twice GMP V out upon twice GMP ROP. So that is equal to zero. Now we have almost towards the end of the calculation. So it says that GMN V in 1 minus V in 2. Now if I take V out in the other side, so we have V out divided by, so I can take them together. So 1 by 2 GMP ROP RON plus 1 upon RON plus 1 upon ROP. So now this GMRO, that product, GMRO PRON, so that product is much larger with respect to 1. So as compared to this RON and ROP in isolation, whenever we call about this particular product, GMP, ROP, RON, so that particular thing is much larger as compared to a single RON or ROP. So therefore, since this GMP, ROP, RON, since this product is much greater than 1, so I can just consider this factor to be negligible. And then ultimately, we find GMN into V in 1 minus V in 2 is equal to V out, and we have 1 upon RON plus 1 upon ROP. So that is nothing but, as you understand, this is nothing but the equivalent resistance of RON and ROP in shunt path. So that is nothing but V out divided by RON parallel with ROP. So now we can find out the expression for gain. So the expression for gain, that is V out upon V in 1 minus V in 2, is coming like, so I can do it over here only. So the expression for gain AV, which is equal to V out upon V in 1 minus V in 2, is simply GMN multiplied with RON parallel ROP. Where RON is the output impedance of the NMOS device, that is M1 and M3, and ROP is the output impedance of the PMOS device, that is M3 and M4. And in fact, we have already seen this type of expression previously whenever we have talked about the fully differential pair. So I can very quickly just draw the fully differential pair with, for example, with a current source load. And let us try to find out the corresponding comparison between these two. So it was a kind of this PMOS as load and NMOS as input device, and obviously this trailing current source, that is ISS. So this is the supply VDD, and if I talk about a current source load, so both of them are supplied with a fixed potential. Let this potential be VB, and I think I can just change the orientation over here. Yeah, so this one V in 1, so these two MOS, M1 and M2, which is used as input device, and the corresponding inputs provided to them are V in 1 and V in 2, and they vary differentially over a common mode level. Their corresponding variations look like this. And we have calculated this Vx minus Vy. In fact, we have seen that this expression for gain AV that is equal to Vx minus Vy upon V in 1 minus V in 2. So that can be calculation can be done using the half circuit concept because the circuit is symmetric in nature. And you have seen that basically, if I just consider this half circuit model involving M1 and M3 only, so then you find that whenever you have applied some input signal over here, some differential input over here, then this is basically a common source stage, nothing more than that. Simple common source stage, input is applied at the gate, and we are taking the output from the drain terminal. So as far as the understanding of common source stage is concerned, the output voltage, Vx, is nothing but the gain multiplied to the input, or the gain expression is given by minus Gm times the R out. Now, what about the R out? So R out, if you just visualize over here, so the R out is nothing but two different resistances which are connected between the drain terminal to the ground terminal, drain to AC ground. So once you have this particular MOSFET, that is M1, so for this MOS1 or M1, we have the drain to source resistance, that is RO1, so which is connected between this point X to this point, and this point was essentially at AC ground because the circuit was symmetric. And accordingly, we have seen that there was another resistance that is coming because of this current source load, and that resistance was like, if I call that resistance like ROP, for example. So now we have one resistance connected between connected from this point to this point, this point to ground, and another resistance which is connected between this point to AC ground. So obviously, the overall output resistance is nothing but the parallel combination of these two. So ultimately, you will find that the overall expression for gain for a half circuit is equal to minus Gm times R1 parallel ROP. That was the one thing. And if I consider the overall expression, so overall expression will be the same. That is minus Gm times RD. So RD will be different depending upon the resistance that you have connected. But in fact, we are getting the magnitude like Gm times RD. And here you find that the corresponding voltage gain is negative in nature. So we have some minus sign outside. But if you take with respect to Vy minus Vx, then it will be positive, no harm done. So that was done using a simple fully differential amplifier with a current source load. Now, what you have to discuss today is a kind of, let me just show you. So in this case, the output is being provided to a differential amplifier, which accepts differential input. Now, instead of that, what we have discussed today is a current source, active load with current mirror, something like this. So that is the only modification what we have done in the load side. And apart from that, the everything remaining same, and the output is single-ended. I'm just drawing these two circuits side by side to make sense what is the difference between them, ISS. So now we are applying the differential input at the gate of MOS 1 and 2 respectively. And now we are interested in taking the output from this terminal with respect to ground. Maybe the next stage, which follows this one, is a single-ended amplifier for some reason. So now, but today what you have observed is this AV, this time it is given by simply V out upon V in 1 minus V in 2. But eventually, these two values, these two AV voltage gain that you are getting being the same with some approximation. Already in our calculation, we have made certain approximations, certain assumptions. Now, with those assumptions, we have seen that this voltage gain remaining the almost same. Now, what is the utility of the first circuit, what we have discussed in the last unit? In fact, here, these two are being provided to a differential amplifier, which accepts differential input like this. Now, if you have, in the following stage, if you have a differential amplifier like this, then obviously you can go by this approach, a differential amplifier with a simple current source load or DAT connected load, no harm done. But suppose you have some differential amplifier over here, and the next stage, you have a single-ended amplifier, which accepts a single-ended input like this. Then obviously, if you just go by this approach, and if you take only one node out of that, either X or Y, then last day we have shown that under this condition, the corresponding gain that you are receiving over here, so it will be just half with respect to Vx. Because if I consider Vx upon Vin1 minus Vin2, that is half with respect to Vx minus Vy upon Vin1 minus Vin2. So for a differential gain over here, if I consider that this gain is equal to 10, Vx minus Vy upon Vin1 minus Vin2, if it is 10, then if you consider a single terminal like X or Y, in that case, the gain will become half, that is 5. So your purpose is not solved. But suppose you have some differential amplifier like this, this is the arrangement, but the next stage is having some amplifier which accepts single-ended input, then obviously, and you have to maintain that the corresponding gain should be preserved. So obviously, you cannot go by this approach. That means you have to change the loading. So instead of using a simple current source load or simple DAT connected load, what we're doing over here is that we have used a current mirror kind of load, so that the amount of so last day we have mentioned that whenever the Vin1 is having a change like this, and Vin2 is having a change like this, a differential change, equal and opposite change. So let this be delta V and minus delta V like this. Then the impact of this positive increment of at Vin1 and the negative increment at Vin2 being the same on Vout, and each of them is going to enhance the gain. So it's not that because of this plus delta V, the Vout is reducing. So last we have shown that using two or three observations that if Vin1 increases by means of say delta V, then Vout is also getting increased. And at the same time, if Vin2 is reduced by delta V, Vout is also getting increased. So that's why whenever we apply both of them together, delta V plus here at Vin1 and minus delta V at Vin2, then the overall impact is to enhance the potential at Vout. So therefore, in this case, you'll find that the gain that we're talking about is positive in nature. So that means there is no such phase difference, because that time we have calculated with respect to Vx minus Vy. But this time we're taking this one only, Vout. So as long as you are maintaining this one, Vin1 minus Vin2 as the differential input, and if you take like Vx minus Vy, then the gain will be negative. But if you take like Vy minus Vx, then the gain will be positive. But instead of using simple current source kind of load or simple DAT connected load, if you use the current mirror load, so that's what is known as the differential pair with active load, because now the amount of current that is flowing through M3 is not, or M4 also, is not constant. It varies with respect to the corresponding variation at the gate potential of M1 and M2. So with this, I can just simply conclude our discussion in unit 4 that was essentially on the current mirror circuit.